have John Pope, who is from Jive, and great bio, comes out of BYU, started the business with some partners back in 2006. I think he's going to tell you a lot about that process and how the ownership compensation structure kind of fits in there. He's been recognized as an Ernst & Young as a finalist in the Entrepreneur of the Year back in 2014. Just a ton of incredible things, but most importantly, he's running a fantastic company that's growing like crazy and has a good story to tell. I became aware of Jive. This is my own personal testimonial of Jive. So I joined a company back in 2005, and one of the problems we had in the early 2006 was I had an employee up in Idaho. I had an employee that worked out of their home in Pleasant Grove. I had two employees at the office in Orem, and we had a couple of different people throughout the country that we had to have regular meetings, and it was a pain in the neck to try to get conferences and try to get them together. And these two young guys came in with this idea that says, we've got this new phone system. It's called Jive. And here's what's great about it is you pay one amount per month per phone, and you can call anywhere, and you can do conferences from here to Idaho to wherever you want to do a conference. It's seamless. It's like they're right in the office. And so I bid on that. And the thing that I found was it actually did what they did. And I could get my voicemail messages from anywhere. This was before that's automatic now. You guys really disrupted the industry. But they had these great features that for a small business, it really allowed me to look like a big business and get a lot of value out of it. So I stuck with Jive the entire time until we sold that business. And then we had to give them the bad news that one of their first customers was moving on. I still have the phone that was in my office that tied to it. So if I'll give you a deal on it if you need it back. Anyway, a great story, a great company. John Pope, give us all you can here.
One of my favorite things to do is to talk with entrepreneurs, talk shop. Jive has an incredible story, and I'm going to get into kind of the best insights that I can possibly give from my experience, from our experience over the 11 or so years that we've been in business. And so again, a pretty incredible story. I'm going to start off with a kind of dumb story, if you're okay with that. My first real job, when I was 17, I worked at Burger King. And so this story is a little bit about compensation, my first experience with compensation, since that's the topic of the day. And back then, this was up in a place called South Hill, Washington. And back then, minimum wage was $4.90 an hour. I know what you guys are thinking. I don't look old enough to have been around in the 1930s. But I assure you that $4.90 at one point was, who am I fooling? $4.90 was never good money. That's what I got paid. It was the only place that would hire me at the time. I took the gig. I worked hard. And I remember one day, a couple months into it, I thought, okay, I got to get up to $5. You know, that's like my dream at the time, get up to $5. So I asked my boss, Cheryl, I went up to her and I said, hey, I've been working hard. I think I'm doing a pretty good job here. I'm at $4.90. Can you give me a dime raise? Can you get me to $5 an hour? I would really appreciate it. She said, well, no, but you can go out and sweep the drive-thru lane and maybe you'll find a dime out there. She was right. Usually you would find stuff out there. So not my best day. One of the only perks at Burger King at the time was that on your break, they would give you a free burger, right? How nice of them. They would give you a free burger, you know, keep you going. And on this particular day, I usually picked a chicken sandwich. That was my favorite. And I made the chicken sandwiches. On this particular day, I thought, you know, this is a little bit rough. You know, I'm going to give myself the best sandwich I possibly can. I just stacked that thing full of everything. I put three chicken patties on it, you know, kind of like I'm gonna get my raise in the form of this chicken sandwich, Cheryl. And I loaded it. Cheryl's looking at me around the corner. I smashed this thing down to kind of look normal size. Couldn't quite do it. The catch was that you couldn't just take it out. You had to go around and actually order it. So I went and put it up on the shelf, walked around, stood in line, and I'm looking forward to this juicy thing. The guy in front of me orders a chicken sandwich. I'm thinking, okay, there's like a 1 in 2 chance. I can see the normal one up there, and then I can see my monster chicken sandwich right behind it. The girl kind of, and like in my mind, this is all slow motion. She reaches back. She's not quite looking at it. She fumbles between the two. And obviously, since mine is so much bigger, she grabs that one and hands it to the guy. And just everything became terrible for me. A bad day went to much worse, and I'm standing there thinking, you know, I have nothing to look forward to for the next 8 hours. And so probably, and at the time, you know, that was probably one of my top 5 worst days. And then somewhere in the dining area behind me, as I'm just, you know, in my worst moment, I hear, "Oh, heck yeah!" And that's the story of the guy that won the chicken sandwich lottery. Like I said, kind of a silly story. Let's get to the good stuff. I don't have a ton of time here. I'm going to talk a little bit about the Jive story. I am fortunate enough to have been, to go from college dropout to, actually no, to go from chicken sandwich guy at Burger King to CEO and co-founder of a several-hundred-million-dollar company. It's been an incredible ride. We've all been extremely blessed to be a part of it. So I'm going to tell you some of the top insights that I've gained. I'm going to talk a little bit about ownership and compensation. And then these things go by super quick. And I love connecting with entrepreneurs, love talking shop. Please reach out to me on LinkedIn. I'm easy to find, John Pope. I may try to sell you the best phone system on the planet. I don't apologize for that. I may also try to hire you. And like was said earlier, we've got our team back there. As you walk out, come and say hi, grab some Jive gear and make a connection there. Speaking of the best phone system in the world, really quickly, so you know the background of this story, the product behind it. Jive pulls together call routing and PBX functionality, local long distance minutes, fax, video conference, audio conference, mobile soft phone, contact center reporting and analytics, and a bunch more. Pulls it all together, and it's cloud-based. You can control this entire thing from one web browser, no matter how many employees, one to a million, and easily the easiest and best phone system to utilize, especially if you're getting started. You want something that has low cost that can scale with you. Okay, roll call here. Raise your hand if you plan to start a business after graduation. Right on. Guy kind of wondering up there, okay. Raise your hand if you plan to gain experience in the job first and then start a business after that. Okay, good mix. Good mix. Some of you guys are voting twice here. Raise your hand if you enjoy learning about entrepreneurship but have no intention of starting a business. We got half a vote up there. And then currently own a business. Okay, cool. Keep your hands raised if you're up to 50,000 in revenue. 100,000? Come talk to me about a phone system. Okay. I like this. We got a lot of people looking to do business here. Quick background on me. I grew up not much money at all, but my parents were all involved in small businesses, kind of blue collar stuff. I learned a ton from my mom and my stepdad, my My current stepdad, I had a couple of them. And my mom owned a clothing store. My first stepdad owned a construction company. My current stepdad had a golf shop, and then he moved into carpet installation. I was always looking for ways to make money. That was my thing when I was a kid. I would go, my main thing was selling baseball cards. I'd go to the card shows and sell. I'd bring stuff to school, try to sell to people. My target market was anybody with lunch money, and it worked out okay. I didn't really think of being a business owner as a career. They weren't teaching that much in school at the time. And it wasn't until the BYU Entrepreneur Lecture Series that I kind of realized that this is just who I am. It's what I wanted to do. And you know, these guys would come in and tell their stories about how they had conquered the world. They'd taken an idea and seen it all the way to you know, millions in revenue. And it was just the most exciting thing that I had heard. And that actually was my inspiration to drop out of school with two, I'm kind of a bad influence, stay in school.
Dropped out of BYU.
Dropped out of BYU, there you go. If I was here, I probably would have finished, right? So I had a moment where I had to decide. I had an opportunity to jump out and start a business. I had two classes left that summer, and I was so inspired by these guys that I decided to go for it. Here's one of my favorite quotes ever. I have the answers to the test now. It's not as hard as it used to be. There was a time when it was really hard for me because you didn't really know what to do. Now I really know what to do. I don't want to stop now. This is when it's really enjoyable. Anybody know who this is? This is Tom Brady. I'm not a Patriots fan. I'm from Seattle. Kind of hate them, but I kind of really admire them at the same time. You know, you take a guy who was at his physical peak 10, you know, 15 years ago, and now is when he's enjoying it the most. This quote, I can't say the same thing. I don't have all the answers to the test, but I'm getting more and more of them. And I can say that it really resonates. This is really when it's the most enjoyable. And I wouldn't have been at this point if I didn't. And if you remember nothing else about what I say, remember this. You've got to get in the game, especially this group. With as much interest as there is in running a business, you have to get in the game at some point. There is no perfect time to start a business. You know, if you've got the money, if you don't have the money to start a business, well, that's rough. If you do have the money to start a business, then you probably have something to lose. You're probably already down a path. You know, if you wait around for a while, then you get used to a certain lifestyle and certain expectations. The life of an entrepreneur is typically a little bit unpredictable. So if you have that in you, if you love adventure, if you like being in control of your destiny, if you like not having a limit to what you can do, if you're sitting here, you have to get in the game. And that's what I did at that point. First business I started was a door-to-door satellite sales company. I had done door-to-door before. It was a lot of fun. This was a perfect company for me to start out with because I knew that if my salespeople couldn't get the job done, I could always go sell myself. I knew that I could sell. So we ramped this up, hit a million in revenue in that first year. I branched out into doing installations for Dish Network. Never would have been able to predict that, but that was a great little business. And it helped me fund my next business, which was an insurance agency. I jumped into this. I kind of was having a hard time with the unpredictability of that sales company. And I thought, you know, these guys, these insurance agents, I see them golfing all the time. They're, you know, they got deep tans. They seem really relaxed. You know, I pay my insurance bill every single month. That sounds like a great business. So I took some of the money I had coming in from the first and poured it into this. Ramped up to 12 people pretty quickly. This business taught me about vertical and ethnic marketing. We sold to the Russian-speaking and the Spanish-speaking communities up in Tacoma, Washington, and it worked out pretty well. We ramped up for 5 years straight. We were the fastest growing AmFam agency in the country. Built up $500,000 in recurring income from this business. And keep in mind, I had no money to start with from anywhere. I don't come from money. I didn't have anything really saved up. And so I poured everything back into these businesses. We were living really pretty lean. Put everything back into these businesses. That was actually only a couple of years. I started these back to back, 2004, 2005. Jive. So how did that all start? So a group of friends of mine had been running a company called Agile Studios. Mark mentioned that these guys were one of the early Junto participating groups. And these guys had been running for about 5-6 years doing custom software development. And at some point, they needed a phone system. They started looking around at the options out there, and everything was hardware-based. Everything was this $20,000 box that sat on site in the back closet. These guys kind of choked on that price tag and decided, you know, being software engineers, they were confident or arrogant enough to think that they could put it all together themselves. So they went and found some open source software, and what do you know, in a day or two, they had a basic functioning system. Now, they started to add features and functionality to this thing. They started to have a little bit of buzz with some customers and friends. I was one of them. I had my two businesses. I had been quoted $20,000, $30,000 for a phone system for these two companies, and I thought, you know, hey guys, give me a shot. Let me try it out. And so I did, and it worked perfectly. I had all these different languages in my insurance agency, needed to route the calls correctly. I had all these technicians running around with my satellite business, and was sick of having everybody's cell phone number to reach them. I needed a system that would pull it all together, and so I was one of the early, pilot users of this. At some point, we got together and said, you know, this thing really has some legs. There's a lot of interest in it, and so, we all kind of realized we had that excitement, and we said, why don't we do this? Let's go for it. We had complementary skills. A bunch of software developers. I was on the growth and sales and marketing side. We had a guy who was kind of a general manager who handled the support early on and a lot of the other functions. And again, in 2006, we decided to go for it. This was a $30 billion plus industry. And so, you know, we figured, hey, if you're going to pick a fight, why not pick the biggest, baddest bully you can possibly find? The groups at the time were Avaya and Cisco and Panasonic, you know, tens of billions of dollars that we were battling against. It was like David versus 10 Goliaths, and David didn't even have a slingshot. He just had his ability to hide behind rocks. And so we kind of stayed under the radar early on. But the thing that made us take that jump was the vision. We felt that phone systems would go from being these clunky things that were expensive, high maintenance, and housed on site to being full-featured and delivered via the cloud, which nobody was talking about the cloud at the time. A lot of people in the industry were skeptical. You know, they said that broadband infrastructure wasn't reliable enough for a voice call to always go through in a way that businesses would expect. People expect cell phones to go down, but when you're on a business call, you can't have that go down, especially from this landline that's been running perfectly for, you know, for decades. And we felt otherwise. We felt that the broadband infrastructure would get better and better, and that if we put in our time and energy, the market would shift, because you can deliver so many things, like I showed before. You can deliver so many different products via the cloud. And so that was our rationale. We didn't do a ton of market validation. We were our own customers, and so we made that bet. We lived off of spouse's income. In my case, my other businesses, I didn't take any money from Jive for probably 3 years, something like that. And so we bootstrapped the thing. And investors at the time were not, how many people here have taken money from an investor? Got a few? Yeah, investors hated our space at the time because there were a bunch of disasters that had happened in the residential voice over IP side. And that kind of put a bad taste in their mouth. Nobody wanted to put money on us. And so we really had no choice but just to bootstrap the thing. Early on, we didn't have any exit strategy. We believed in where this thing would go long term. And we started out kind of the classic disruptor model. If you're going to disrupt an industry, a lot of times you start at the low end. You start at the consumer level, and for us, we started at the small business level and kind of worked out a lot of the kinks, worked our way up. We went from small business a few years later. As revenue started to climb from, 100,000 to 400,000 to 1 million, 2 million, 5 million over those first few years, we made a shift. We decided, okay, eventually we need to sell to larger organizations, and we picked public sector and K-12 as kind of this protected area that nobody else was going after, and we sunk our teeth into it fully, and it worked out beautifully for us. The competitive environment was perfect. It taught us how to deploy these large 1,000+ employee organizations. And that helped us eventually launch into larger commercial deployments. We grew organically for about 7 years. We got up to around $25 million in annual run rate. And at that point, investors were kind of banging down our door. That's kind of the beauty of bootstrapping. You build a business, you prove it, and investors then come your way. We skipped the VC rounds, and if anybody here knows about growth equity, these investors pick groups that have already kind of proven the model, and then they put money into it, and they kind of expect it to accelerate. They're not looking over your shoulder as much. They're not looking for, they're not looking to redline these businesses and hope to hit a grand slam on one of them, and then, 5-10 of them flame out. These guys expect a continuation of the model and the success that they invest in. As we took money from these guys, we took about $20 million in primary funding and poured it into growth, and then we poured it into product development. So that we kind of picked the toughest path. It's crazy to look back, but we decided to build our own platform. We felt that would be important to differentiate ourselves. And then we also chose to sell our own product, and we chose to do it with very little money. That was kind of the toughest combination that we could have gone with. At this point, we are closing in on $100 million in yearly revenue. That means a lot, I think, when you look at the amount that we've taken. We took about $18 million. A lot of companies, to get to $100 million, it will take $100, $200+ million. And so that's something we're really proud of. We just passed 500 employees. We've got customers in 25 plus countries. We've got industry leading net promoter score, which is essentially your customer satisfaction. And we've got the highest platform capacity for customer size and total customer base. There you go. That's a bit of the Jive story in about 15 minutes. Any questions before I get into some of the insights and a little bit on, again, compensation and ownership? Got one way back there, one right here.
I guess my first question is, can you tell us more on how you got into the satellite business? How did that begin?
Yeah, that was, okay, so yeah, how did I get into the satellite business? That was super easy. I had been selling door to door already during the summers. I did well at it. And to me, there was very little risk. I wasn't already in a career. My wife and I didn't have a high standard of living. And so I felt like, let's do what I already have been doing and try to scale it, try to hire people and expand from there. So it was a very safe move for me. A real easy decision. I had sold pest control and then satellite TV.
Cool. So how much money did you and your other founders have to bootstrap until you actually got funding? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Because I don't know, but typically when you're dealing with a startup, there's a lot of capital associated at the very initial stage, and then typically you live on very little for a period of time.
Yeah, so we were... I was extreme with my businesses prior. We maybe lived off of like $1,500 to $2,000 a month while I was reinvesting. Because every $3,000 a month you take home personally is $3,000 that you could have reinvested, which would have become 6, 12, 24, and so on. That a lot of times is the difference between a scaling company and a small business. The owner is looking to, you know, take the additional home. So to answer your question, we were extreme about it. We took very little money, and we didn't have much either. It was just kind of sweat equity. There were a few of us, and just to, you know, skip to one of the parts later, having business partners is a form of bootstrapping. You don't have money to hire people. Well, you share ownership, and you bring in more people right from the start.
So we didn't pay ourselves for quite a while, and when we did, it started to be like $500, $1,000 a month, and then eventually we started paying ourselves more years down the road. But we really didn't have any capital. We did take a little bit of debt. You guys may want to look into venture debt or revenue-based financing, sort of like a more startup-friendly type of loan. We use a little bit from InnoVentures locally and Lighter Capital based in Seattle. So that's a little tip for you. Okay, one more here.
Sorry, can I have like two?
Is that fine?
Let's go one.
Okay. Well, when you're first starting with your sales, I imagine it was just you.
Was it just you?
It was all of us trying to sell, but yeah, I was kind of heading it up.
Okay, so when you're first starting your sales, did you have to go through like a list, or did you do some networking, or what was the most successful way for you? I imagine it's a satellite kind of.
Well, okay, with my first company, we just did door to door. That was the easiest thing. And with the second company, we did ethnic vertical marketing and did nothing but referrals, 100% referrals. With Jive, we started off with Google AdWords and with referral sites.
People who were kind of early adopters, look interested in the technology, and so we're searching for it. So I guess we outsourced our lead qualification to these online groups and then paid for them inbound. And that was an excellent way to get started at the beginning.
Thank you. Good questions here. Keep pushing through. Top tips. Now, we've been talking a little bit about that. With bootstrapping, I'm going to make these very, very simple. I could talk for hours about each one of them. Bootstrapping, you want to pay yourself very little. You want to reinvest in the company as quickly as you can, and you want to reinvest in activities that bring you more revenue, because that gives you the flexibility and the power to continue to expand. So you outsource things at first, like legal, HR, even finance a lot of the time, and you pour all your money into sales, leads, product, stuff like that. You kind of stack the deck a little bit. And vertical marketing. If you have a very small amount of funding to work with, then you focus it somewhere and you become the absolute best in that market. Fundraising. I think a lot of people feel like fundraising is something that is almost like a goal in itself. Fundraising is a means to an end. Fundraising, if your car was having trouble, would the solution be to go and put a bunch of fuel in it? Obviously not. That's kind of how I like to have people look at fundraising. And investors want to put fuel in a machine that's working, that can utilize that fuel. So when you know what the next step is, and you can't get there without the help of outside funding, that's a good time to look at outside funding. And it's an incredible resource. You just have to do it right, because investors expect a return. They expect it in a certain time frame. And you have a responsibility to help them achieve that after you bring them on. Vertical marketing, I talked about that a little bit already. Again, that's extremely key, really, to every one of my businesses, and it's been key at Jive. We've expanded into several verticals at this point. Another one, document all of your processes. You can't improve a recipe that isn't written down. And you can't train somebody on a recipe that isn't written down. And a ton of your value in your business, if you're going to scale, if you're going to get to high growth, is in your processes. You need to write them down. You need to document them. What every different group does, what every individual does. And when things go wrong with a customer, you don't meet your goals, you go back to the process that you've got and you change it, you tweak it. You have a scientific mentality about this stuff. Specialization. One of the main differences between a small business and a large or growing business is that in the small business, people wear 10 different hats, and they're very good at a bunch of them. They're shifting gears all the time. In order to scale, you have to start taking those most important activities and assigning a single person or a single group to these things. I coach baseball. I don't try to teach every kid every different position. I want the guy who's at second to learn second base. I want the catcher to become extremely good at catching. And that's kind of the same mentality that you need to have in business. Ownership and compensation. Real quick, rule of thumb. If you're planning to be a high growth company, you're considering taking venture capital, maybe going public someday, you want to offer employee stock options, go with a C Corp. If you're looking at running a small business with fewer owners, you're not planning on going big or taking venture capital, LLC, limited liability, is a great way to go. Always go get the counsel of a business attorney on that stuff, but that's kind of some rule of thumb insight from me. Okay, this is important for you guys. As you start your companies, you're going to be thinking, well, this is a crazy adventure that I'm heading out on. It would sure be nice to have a buddy along with me. That is not a good reason to have a business partner. Again, business partners are almost like a way of bootstrapping when you can't afford to pay somebody. You want to bring on a business partner when they've got kind of a complementary skill set, you don't have the budget, and you both have the same long-term vision and expectations, you enjoy working with that person. This, I think, is really important at the stage that you guys are at. Don't be tempted to jump into something with a business partner just because you want a friend to be there, because it's an intimidating journey. You'll get past the thing being intimidated, and then you'll be sitting next to somebody, you know, tied at the hip, who may have completely different goals than you do. Compensation. Good compensation won't ensure that you'll attract and retain top talent, but bad compensation will ensure that you'll fail at it. Real quick, don't need the mics for this. Anybody know why? Why would that be the case?
People value more their work environment and be appreciated more than they can be paid.
Spot on. Companies retain people who are valued members of a cause they believe in. That was right on. If you got time to come to the lunch afterwards, you're invited. So this is huge. Build a culture that people want to be a part of and that they want to refer their friends into. Compensation, no matter how much you pay, will not achieve that for you. But just some quick insights. Start by paying market compensation levels. Find a third party. Do what you need to do to understand what the market is paying for those positions. If I could go back and do it again, I would pay market. I started out bootstrapping. I'm thinking I want to get a good deal everywhere. And, you know, I paid lower. I got a lot of people who were capable. I got also a bunch of people who, didn't really perform at the levels that we eventually needed. And I would do that differently next time. Whenever possible, use variable compensation to drive specific results. Commission for sales, bonus for management. MBO is management by objective. You have a certain thing you need, build a customer loyalty program in Q4. And if they do it, they get paid for it. These are some parts of the compensation structure that you want to put in. To me, it's almost always better to have base plus bonus, base plus commission, so that people are motivated to reach for more throughout the year. And then lastly, give employees some skin in the game. If you got a high growth company, give out stock options. If you guys are familiar with vesting ensures that if you give people a stock option opportunity when you hire them, that that will only take effect if they stick around, if they make it, if they're the right fit, because 25% of it will vest in the first year, for example, and then maybe half of it by the second year. And so you end up having them kind of earn their way into it, but they know they've got some upside right to start. And then in small businesses, if you're in an LLC, share a little bit of the, the gold at the end of the year. Do some profit sharing. Not sure. Okay, I won't get into this. We've got about, 5 minutes left. I want to do a couple more questions. We did a commit bonus at Jive. We told our sales team to pick the target that you think you want to hit. And if you hit it, we'll pay you. And we wanted to know what they thought that they could produce. And if they picked a high enough one, we would give them 3 or 4 times the money that they would have gotten. Kind of a cool program to find out what people believe that they can do. Some people had a little bit less than quota. It was interesting. It was useful. We have the same metrics for executive team bonuses, so we are all aligned around growth and profit. And then we do a company-wide bonus based on company growth and net promoter score, where we take the entire company on a retreat. Everybody in the company, we take them on a retreat. Depending on how well we do, determines the location of that retreat. But that's been a really fun one. And I believe that you should have a goal target for everybody in the entire company. Okay, let's see if we can take maybe 1 or 2 more questions here. Up front.
What role does culture play with compensation? You talked about how compensation isn't what can really keep people, but culture can. How does that play within the ownership perspective, though? Not just for your employees, but what role does culture play in keeping you there tied with compensation?
So what role does culture play in keeping the owners?
Yes.
man. You know, kind of a softer answer on that. I think culture keeps everybody there. Doesn't matter if you're an owner, doesn't matter if you're a new employee. It really has nothing to do with, you know, what your role is or how long you've been there. You know, sometimes owners or people, you know, who've been there early on are tied to the upside financially. But I've seen people leave, you know, who have a big upside because they don't fit with the people that they're working with. And so culture is critical for everybody. You know, that to me is more important. You know, you focus on culture and then everything else kind of falls into place. Yeah. Other questions here?
So I guess my question is more of a, I don't know if you guys did this, but I just kind of have
a question for a company that I'm trying to work with. And one of the things that we're dealing with is, as a startup, going into a contract, we have the opportunity to go into a big contract, but we're not sure we can finance the first operating costs. I was wondering if you had suggestions how to get started on that or just to stay to lower contracts.
Why don't you come to the lunch? I don't know if you have time, or reach out to me. That's it. Okay, there, yeah. Everything is context specific. And so I would love to hear a little bit more context on that. And by the way, we're about, you know, getting to the end here. Please reach out on LinkedIn. Please, if you have questions going forward, I would love to, you know, take you to lunch. I'll buy you a triple stack chicken sandwich. Please do not be afraid to reach out.
I just had the one question. So, I mean, you started the insurance company. I mean, there's probably a lot of red tape. I mean, I don't know that. How did you? What type of state of mind did you have to put yourself in order to think, okay, I could start an insurance company and I can figure these things out?
Yeah, that's a great question.
Because I mean, sure, that doesn't sound easy.
I never thought that I would get into insurance. Yeah, and there was a lot of you know, licensing and stuff that I had to learn. But honestly, I got into it. I probably sold 20 policies out of, you know, what was it, 6,000 or something like that, at the height. I immediately started to bring in experts. So I didn't, you know, I didn't personally feel like I was going to do all of that stuff. And the other part of it is I just had an appetite where I could not sit on the sidelines. You know, I had one business and I needed to expand, and that led to Jive. If I wouldn't have done those first two, I never would have seen the opportunity to jump into.
Did you feel like you hit roadblocks where you're just like, I don't know what to do now. Where do I go to find out this answer?
In insurance?
Or even the satellite company. Where do I get licensed for this? How do I get permission to do
that? Yeah, that's interesting. I didn't have a mentor, and I wish I had. I had to figure out a lot of things on my own. I had to hire people who were experts, and that's kind of the way that I went. In every case, I hired people who were experts, and I kind of learned from them. I think I had good instincts, but I needed to pair it with people who had experience. But yeah, I kind of wish I had a mentor at the time. It ended up turning out well.
Okay, I think we're there.
Tell us about Jive's culture.
Jive's culture.
Was it like Google? Was it like?
I have no idea. Google, yeah. Jive's culture is one of people want to show what they're capable of. There's not a lot of hype. There's more of a get in and prove it and work with other people who are proving it. I think top talent, top performers want to work with other top performers. I believe that thoroughly, and I think we've proven that. At Jive, there isn't a ton of hype. There's a lot of capability, a lot of intelligence. You know, anybody who that resonates with, again, stop by and talk with us afterwards. We'd love to have you on board. But we have people who stick around for a long time, not very much turnover. It feels a little bit more like a family, but it's a well-functioning team. So appreciate the softball you threw at me right there.
Okay, let's hear it for John. Listen to Greg.